Hello, my name is Sławomir Kapka. I'm from Samsung R&D Institute Poland, and I'll talk about ID conditioned autoencoder for unsupervised anomaly detection. I'll start by overviewing task 2 from this year's DCAS challenge. Then I'll talk about the relation between unsupervised anomaly detection and open set recognition problem. Then I'll introduce our solution called ID conditioned autoencoder, and I'll end up with the results showing the ablation study. So task 2 considered unsupervised anomaly detection for machine condition monitoring. Unsupervised anomaly detection means that we train our system only on normal samples. And then during the inference, we have to tell whether the new sample is normal or anomalous. Actually, the problem is a little bit easier. Our system should output some abstract anomaly score. Low anomaly score correspond to normal samples, large anomaly score correspond to anomalous samples. This is due to the fact that the final score for the system is computed using area under Rock curve. So the anomaly score suffice. So in this task, we have 6 machine types, and each machine type consists of distinct IDs for training and for the evaluation. We'll exploit this last assumption heavily in our solution. So the open set recognition problem is problem of detecting unknown classes for classifiers. So for example, if we have a classifier which tells us whether in the picture there is a dog or cat, and we feed the system with the picture of horse, then it should tell us that it's neither a dog nor a cat. It is an unknown object. So this is the open set recognition. And unsupervised anomaly detection can be seen as a degenerated example of open set recognition problem. We train the system only on normal samples, and anomalous samples can be seen as unknowns. So for right now, the state of the art for open set recognition problem is class conditioned autoencoder, which we heavily based our solution on. So I'll first describe it briefly. And actually I will simplify a little bit. So the class conditioned autoencoder consists of 2 things, classifier and conditional autoencoder. So during the training phase, we first train the classifier in a normal way, and we train this conditional autoencoder in such a way that we give it an input with the condition, which is the label corresponding to its class. So it is a matching label, and we expect it to reconstruct the input faithfully, resulting in low reconstruction error. Also, we give this input with non-matching label, so label corresponding to some other class, and we expect it to reconstruct some rubbish, let's say, resulting in high reconstruction error. During the inference, also simplifying, we give it an input, we feed it through the classifier. This classifier gives us some class, and then we feed it to the autoencoder, this input, with the label predicted from the classifier. And if the reconstruction error is low, then we conclude that it is a known class. And if the reconstruction error is high, then we conclude that it is an unknown sample. If you are confused, don't worry. I'll describe our solution in more details. But our solution is roughly based on this idea. So the point of class conditioned autoencoder is to separate distribution of known and unknown. So as you can tell from this picture, those distributions behave similar to matches and non-matches. So our solution, ID conditioned autoencoder. So let's say if we have a fixed machine type and we exploit the fact that we have various IDs of this machine. So in our system, IDs correspond to labels. So like in the class conditioned autoencoder, classes correspond to labels. In our case, IDs correspond to labels. This is this adaptation that we have done. In more details, our system consists only of conditional autoencoder, which is made of encoder, decoder, and conditioning. In our system, conditioning is made of two functions that if we have this latent vector, then we multiply this latent vector element-wise by the output of the first function and add the second, the output from the second function. So this conditioning, it maybe looks like affine transformation of latent space. So it is quite rigid. Overall, given an input and conditioning, we feed this input to the encoder, then condition it on L, and finally we feed it to the decoder. And this is the output of our system. How we train it? So we wish that our system reconstruct X faithfully if and only if it is a normal sample and it is conditioned by the matching label. So we train it in the following way. Given an input, X, which is a normal sample, because it is unsupervised anomaly detection, so we train the system only on normal samples. We set the label L to match with some probability alpha or to non-match with probability 1 minus alpha. So if we have a batch, then approximately alpha fraction of samples will be matches and the rest will be non-matches. So if we have a match, then we expect our system to reconstruct X. And if we have non-match, then we expect our system to reconstruct vector C. The C is analog to this rubbish from the class conditioned autoencoder. So given a match, it should behave like a normal autoencoder, and if it's non-match, then it should output constant vector C. During the inference, we feed the network always with the matching labels. And there may be three cases. If the sample is normal, then we expect the reconstruction to be faithful, because this corresponds to this first case from the training procedure. If the sample is anomalous, there may be two cases. First, the sample is nothing like any sample during training, then the autoencoder generally wouldn't be able to reconstruct it, resulting in high reconstruction error. So this is the behavior like any other autoencoder, even without conditioning. So those two cases correspond to normal autoencoder behavior. But the last one is interesting. If an anomalous sample resembles normal samples with other IDs, then the autoencoder will try to reconstruct this vector C. So if we have some anomalous sample, which looks like normal sample from with other ID, then we would may look at it as a normal sample with the mismatched ID. So this corresponds to this second case from the training procedure. So it in fact will try to reconstruct this constant vector C, and the reconstruction error will be high. The architecture of our network is quite simple. We feed it with the windows of standardized logMAL power spectrograms. All encoder, decoder, and conditioning are made of fully connected neural networks. The interesting thing is that encoder is a little bit smaller than decoder, but the rest is very similar to the DK's baseline system. We train it also very similarly to the DK's baseline system, so the details are in the paper, so I'll leave it there. How does it work in practice? So here we have a few examples from the test set. So first, normal samples. If we condition it on matching labels, then we see that the reconstruction is quite faithful. But if we feed it with non-matching labels, then the system tries to reconstruct this constant vector C, resulting in high reconstruction error. Sorry. If we take some anomalous samples from the test set, then we see that our system tries to reconstruct this constant vector C in the timestamps when this anomalous behavior appear. Yeah, so this is like additional advantage of our system, and the reconstruction error is also boosted due to this fact. overall, this, the distribution of the reconstruction error looks like that. So the normal samples with matching labels should be separated from the anomalous samples with matching labels. But as you can tell, the overlap is quite big, but this is as good as we get. We wish that this green distribution would be closer to this orange one, but this is what it is. We'll talk about the results using the ablation study. The ablation study is a process that when you have a system and you can split it into steps, starting from some baseline, then you see how each step influences the result. So we start with the decays baseline system, which is just fully connected autoencoder. Then we change some make some changes to the architecture. We change the encoder, set latent layer from 8 units to 16, and change the frame size from 5 to 10. In the next step, we standardized our input. In the next one, we add this conditioning, which we introduced. In the next one, we added some more labels. So we have this train data set and additional data set, which both consists of normal samples. But training sets have some IDs and additional data sets have some other IDs. So we combine those into one data set for training. And in the last step, we done an assemble, trying different hyperparameters. So the assemble ends working in such a way that actually you have here the all six machine types. So for each machine type, we trained some models, we selected three best ones, and we tried a linear combination of those. Linear combination means that we tried linear combination of this abstract anomaly scores. And as you can tell, the linear combination in most cases works the best. So the final results, by the boldface, we denoted the best scores, and by underline, we denoted the greatest improvement. As you can tell, the results vary from machine to machine, so it's best to look at the average. We have two scores, area under rock curve and partial area under rock curve. This partial area focuses more on avoiding false calls. That means telling that some normal sample is anomalous. It tries to avoid such situations. So as you can tell, this conditioning improves a lot this partial area under curve metric, and adding more classes, more labels or more IDs improves both metrics. So in our case, it is better to add more classes, if you can. And the assemble was constructed in such a way that it have to give us the better performance than the previous step. So this is all. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to contact me. Thank you.